And it's great to worship the Lord with everybody in His house. We don't take it for granted that we can come here in this beautiful place and worship the Lord. And even though the basketball is going on next door, let's focus our attention on the Lord. So today we started our series, the home series. And the idea is that we belong to heaven, and the world is not our home. And the thing is that we may become too comfortable in this world and think that this place is our home. It is not. And God doesn't intend us to be comfortable in this home, in this world. And so let's read this verse together. John 15:19. You do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. Sorry, it didn't come out very well. The part that I would like to emphasize. And so the part you do not see very well is that you do not belong to the world. And I have chosen you out of this world. That's Jesus told his disciples before he was crucified and sent to heaven. Thank you. And second verse, dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desire which wage war against your soul. And what do aliens mean? What do aliens mean? It doesn't mean extraterrestrial, like an ET kind of life form. It means we are foreigners in this world. And so when we first came to this country as an immigrant, we got an alien registration card, right? And alien means we are foreigners. We don't belong, our citizenship doesn't belong to this country. And so it's called alien. And 1 Peter said, I urge you as aliens and strangers in this world. And so if we are alien to this world, where is our home? And so in Philippians 3:20 says, our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await the Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. So our citizenship is in heaven. So if you have a passport, I don't know which passport you hold, either US or China or some other countries in the world, but our citizenship, our true citizenship that we hold right now, is heaven. And in 1 Peter it also said, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a holy nation. So that nation is heaven. But we have a problem, right? And so very few of us have been to heaven and then come back. And so even though we are the citizen of heaven, we have never been there. And we don't really know what it's like in heaven. And so in this series, we hope to unpack and give you a few pictures, and you can remember in your mind what it is our home like in heaven. There are actually a lot of description in the scripture talking about heaven. And we're not going to go into the mysterious stuff. There's a lot of things in heaven that the scripture was not very clear. But we are going to be very clear on the things that scripture was very clear about. And there's no ambiguity. And there's no mystery. And so that's the four series we're going through. And the first one today we're going through is worship. but I think there's one more. And do not love the world. And so if our citizenship is in heaven, and the scripture told us, do not love the world, it warned us so much that if you love the world, the love of the Father is not with you. And so I think this is a pretty strong statement. So if we love this world too much, we may lose desire to even go to heaven and lose our citizenship. It's not like we are kind of our citizenship is revoked. It is not. It is because we love this world too much that we forsake the citizenship from heaven. So this is something the scripture warns us not to do. And hopefully through this series, we can remind you or give you a vivid picture of what is heaven like. And to make sure that we are all familiar with our home. So when one day we go to heaven, you are not like, okay, this is not the place I want to be. And so we got acclimate to heaven, even on earth. And so let's go to our today's topic, worship. And so let's actually read today's verse of scripture. It's pretty long. I only put half of the scripture on the Sunday bulletin. But let's read the entire scripture and in its totality, and then we can move on to the description part. Can we all see? Okay, let's read together. Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, "Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?" But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has fallen. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw a lamb, looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders, and the lamb has seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out from the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of him and sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayer of the God's people. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open the seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe, language, and people, and nation. And you have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on earth." Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000, encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." The four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. Okay, let's pray before I expound this part of the scripture. Our Father in heaven, we worship you because you are worthy. You are worthy because you are a good God. You are good to us. You created us. You breathed the life inside of our nostrils so we can be united with you. But we were fallen, and Jesus came to redeem us and to make us your own, to make us a nation that belongs to you. Father God, in this morning as we expound this concept of worship, Lord, give us a heart of worship and submission so that we can truly understand what worship is and why we need to do that. Help us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. When I first become a Christian, I don't know about you, and I don't really understand worship. And unlike other religion, and they have some kind of idols, and we worship a invisible God. And people sing praise and things, and almost like if you don't understand it, you are watching a bunch of crazy people and worship an invisible God. And I don't really understand it. And as I grow spiritually, and I contemplate on this concept of worship, I realize many of us may be in the same boat as I was. And we don't really feel like worship. And we don't really want to open our mouths to worship. And we even question why God demands worship. And so let's actually look at why we worship. And before we look at worship, actually, what is worship? What is worship? Worship is something actually we all do, right? And so that you hear that some sports stars is really good, and whoever that is in your mind, and people worship them. And if some athletes are really good, right, people worship them and put their posters on their wall and really kind of adore them. And some people like music, and a lot of music stars, and whoever is your music star, you can think about them. And people worship them. They go to their concert screaming, right? And cannot wait to meet them in person, even though it costs like hundreds and hundreds of dollars to be in front of them. And people worship all kinds of idols too. And if you go travel in China, India, and in Buddha temples or whatever, there's a lot of people light incense in front of the God they don't even know. I mean, there are so many gods in the Buddha temple, and people worship the God they do not know. So worship is something people, somehow human beings, are drawn to do. You don't see that the animals get together as one herd and to worship something, right? You don't see the cows and dogs and cats and come on the day, what is the cat's day, Friday, and come together to worship something. So humans are the only creature that are created to worship. And but we have a problem. A lot of time we don't seem to have that excitement. And in fact, one pastor commented that people meet with celebrity with excitement and a scream. But they meet with the biggest celebrity, Jesus, with a yawn and a shrug. And so among Christians, this is also common. So what went wrong? And so I read a story. So some number of years ago, a woman in Kansas City and walking to Haagen-Dazs ice cream shop, right? And while he waiting in line, he turned around and saw this guy. and what should I say, handsome. And he was actually, at that time, Paul Newman was in Kansas City filming this movie, Mr. and Mrs. Bridge. And he happens to walk into this Haagen-Dazs ice cream shop, and behind this lady, and lady was kind of his biggest fan, right? And so she turned around and saw this Paul Newman, and Paul Newman saw her, then smiled at her and said, hello. And then she was so nervous, right? And she met the kind of the star of her dream, and she turned around and she tried to speak, but no word came out. And then she grabbed her ice cream and paid for the ice cream and quickly walked out of the store. And then outside, she sat on the bench and kind of tried to catch her breath and calm down, right? And after she calmed down, she realized she couldn't find the ice cream. And she was like, where's my ice cream? And so she walked around debating whether she should walk back to the store and to get it. And so finally she decided to walk back to the store, and Paul Newman actually walked out of the store and said, oh, are you looking for something? And the lady was like, I'm looking for my ice cream. And the Paul Newman said, you put the ice cream cone in your purse with your change. And so the people are mortified and excited, and to the extent they lose their selves, right? And when they see celebrities. But when we come here, we meet the biggest celebrity in the world, Jesus. And we don't seem to always have that kind of excitement and put the ice cream along with the change in our purse or whatever, man's purse. And when we come here, and so what went wrong in our heart? Because we are created to worship. So in the act of worship, there are two parts, right? There is the worshiped, the subject of our worship, and there's the worshiper. So let's look at both of them kind of in this order. Let's look at the worship. In the verse we just read, the Lamb was slain, and we worship Jesus. And some of us may think that, may ask, why God asked us to worship Him? Does He really have that big ego that He has to kind of get that worship, like say, oh, okay, now I'm God, right? And you guys are the things that I created. Does He like really needs it? What do you think? Does God need our worship? Does God need our worship? Right answer. God doesn't need our worship. God deserves our worship. God wants our worship. But God doesn't need our worship. He created heaven and earth and everything in it. All other creatures, their existence worship God. So in Psalm says, the heavens declare His glory. The stars speak of His way. The galaxies, the stars, the heaven, the Milky Way, the forests, the mountains, the valleys, the lakes, and the beautiful flowers. They worship by their mere existence. Their existence speaks volume in their worship of their creator. Just by being there, those things, organic or inorganic, worship their creator. But we humans are different. We are created in the image of God. Our mere existence doesn't worship God. And in fact, our mere existence, presence here in this sanctuary, does not necessarily worship God. We humans are different from any other creature in that we have to willingly submit ourselves before God to be called worshiper. All other things, stars, galaxies, forests, lakes, mountains, flowers, trees, insects, dogs, cats, their existence themselves, their being alive, their being there, speaks the majesty of the Creator. But we humans, we live. If we don't worship our God, our mere existence doesn't worship. And God wants our willing worship. So in gospel, it's actually Jesus said, if you don't worship me, the rock will cry out, Jesus is the Lord. But now, get back to the question, why God does not need our worship? But he wants our worship. Why is that? Let me illustrate with a very simple example everybody can relate between the parents and the children. Do parents need children's love? Do parents need children's love to survive? Right? Need is a very strong word. Do parents need children's love to survive, to live? Yes, no? No. Parents do not need children's love to survive, to live. We were perfectly fine without the children before we were married, when we got married, before we have kids. We were perfectly fine. Parents do not need children to survive, to live. But after we have children, we desire children's love. It's not something like will sustain us, but it's something really make our days special. You see, needs and wants are different kind of things. God doesn't need our worship, but he wants our worship. Just like parents do not need the love of children to survive, but parents long for the love of the children to make their day. And children, when you love your parents, you make their day. And like our worship, when we worship God, we make God's day. But it's not like God needs our worship to be eternally present. So worship, just like love between children and parents, is the bonding between the two parties to keep the relationship going and to keep this life meaningful. And we are here to worship God. We're not here to do God a favor by giving him the praise that he deserves. It's not something that he needs, but it's something that he deeply, deeply desires. We are here to foster this strong bond that existed before the creation of the earth, that meant to be between us and our Creator. So now, if God doesn't need our worship, who needs worship? The worshipers need worship. You probably say, that's strange, right? It's a bad deal. And you meant to say that I came here to pay our respect to God, and it is for us. And we sing the songs and all that. And actually, the beneficiaries is us. I would say, yes, a resounding yes. Why? The fundamental answer is that the worship fulfills the purpose we are created. We are created to do what? The ultimate goal of our being. The pastor Scott, and on that day, the day that Ad Troy was ordained, the one message is that is what? Our existence is to glorify God. That's why we are made. And we need worship to remind who we are. And I would even venture to say this. So prayer is a weapon to fight the difficult situation. But worship is a weapon for us to fight the desperate situation. So in the time of need, and we come to pray, right? And in the time of desperation, there's no hope. What do you do? What do? You run out of prayers, and there seems to be no answer. What do? I suggest we worship. I know some of our people in this congregation are going through very hard situations in your home or school. It's not only the time to pray. It's time to worship. Why? I believe worship does three things magically. So the first thing, when we adore his name, we release the power of his name in us. And we recognize who he is. After we recognize who he is, we confirm who we are. So last series was about I am, right? We talked about the different aspects of God's deity, humanity. Only after we proclaim his name in our heart can we be a